The main problem was that after that crash, also I had an injury in the ankle, but also I make some damages on the bike that we didn't understand at the beginning. So I make Le Mans race and Aragon 1 race and Friday of Aragon 2 with the same bike in general. But then I was very slow. The feeling was not good every time. I had a lot of problems on the bike. Hi there, welcome to the Last on the Brakes MotoGP podcast, the show which will give you the most in-depth chat about MotoGP you could ever have and some just downright silly questions which nobody really needed to ask, but it's entertaining all the same. My name's Matt Dunn, alongside me as ever in 2021, Fran Wild. And Fran, who are we speaking to today?
You started off super promo.
Yeah, I did actually.
Straight out the blocks, like, hello, this is our product.
But it's because we forgot to do the script for this one. Well, we've just run out of time, but oh well.
So yeah, today's guest anyway will be the inimitable Luca Marini. We thought it was a good guest to have on. Obviously, rookie and starting his MotoGP career this weekend. Good chat. We did speak to him a couple of years ago, if you listen to the former form of the podcast. But we thought we'd go back and revisit. Now he is, like we said, making his Premier Class debut.
And bringing
those
one.
Beautiful Sky VR46 colours to the grid.
Yes, exactly that. Luca Marini, as you all know, half-brother to Valentino Rossi as well. Owner of probably the most fabulous hairstyle, I would say, on the grid. We didn't ask him about that. And unfortunately, if you are watching on YouTube, it is not visible either underneath the sponsored up cap. But you have mine to deal with instead, the unkept lockdown do, which
sadly is visible.
Yeah, all of you guys will be probably experiencing at home as well. But Luca, we did ask him about a variety of different topics, didn't we? We really like coming, well, me particularly, I don't know how bored fans are getting of it, but I like coming back to support systems and talking about
the people
around the riders that lift them up and keep them grounded and all of that. So that was a really
interesting topic for sure. And I personally love like the progress and how you make that. It's just kind of crazy because you get people with such different paths into the Premier Class, and Lucas is a little bit different. And like we touch on as well, his method of doing things, everything's like so methodical and similar to how I do things sometimes, when you just like, okay, so like this needs to be here, this needs to be here, and then you just kind of,
I think we saw that at the end of the show, didn't we? We've got some quick fire questions,
but actually
the final one, he was stumped.
We got a refusal.
Well, almost a refusal.
There wasn't enough time to come up with a quality answer that would be true.
So what you can say is Luca Marini answers quickfire podcast questions in the same manner that he analyses his data on his MotoGP bike. Or does he do it in that much detail anymore? You might hear differently in the podcast because he did mention that
So yeah, basically we'll stop waffling now.
Yeah.
Please enjoy the first episode of 2021. Comments, I was going to say abajo. I'll get back into English by the time we're a few rounds in. Please comment below if you're watching on YouTube and let us know what you thought of it. And of course, on whatever podcast form platform of choice.
Well, yeah, got
and
a request about
use
that.
Use
the hashtag MotoGP podcast and so to get in touch with both of us. That would be fantastic. Let us know what you think. If we really do need a script for these intros again, I promise we'll do it for the second episode. But also, please actually do us a favor. If you really did enjoy the show last year and also this year, if you could leave us a review on your preferred podcast platform, that would be fantastic. And if you could recommend it to a friend of yours who likes MotoGP or just wants to listen to a sporting podcast. It is very much racing based, but we get into some general topics, which I think are relevant to a broader audience as well sometimes. That's what we try to anyways, isn't it?
And assuming that you have actually listened to this intro, which I do not normally when I listen to podcasts, thanks for staying with us. And now, without further ado, here's Luca Marini. So, welcome back to another season, I guess. It feels a little bit strange after so much time to be back here. And as I'm sure you've seen from the title in your podcast app or wherever you're listening or watching on YouTube, the first guest of the season is Luca Marini, who you did join the podcast a couple of years ago on the old format of show. So if anyone listened to that, there's some details on exactly how you got here and sort of childhood and everything. But we thought, it's a pretty perfect moment to talk to you again, making your MotoGP debut. that's where we've got to start. How does it feel now coming to Qatar as a MotoGP rider?
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, it's fantastic. The feeling is amazing. Also, is becoming everything better. Also, I understand more these feelings every day a little bit more, because in the first test when I was here last week, it was not the same. The day before to start ride the bike, I was not emotional like now. Now I'm feeling something different, because you know, you see the paddock full of people.
It's a different vibe, isn't
yeah,
it,
exactly.
When everyone's here.
With all the other riders, Moto2, Moto3, so it's a totally different vibe.
So when you woke up this morning, because I often think with these things that there's not always a specific moment where you go, ah, or like eureka, but was this morning feeling different? When you got up, you put your socks on, you had breakfast, coming to the track for the first time for a full media day as a MotoGP.
Or?
Yeah, just, yeah, he only wearing socks.
Yeah.
was that different, or did it get to 10 a.m. and you thought, oh, I'm a MotoGP rider, yeah.
No, it's not just one specific moment, I think, but a little bit more when I arrived to the paddock today, because I was here also yesterday. We do a lot of photos, a lot of filmings, but today that I saw the paddock ready to start is different, the feeling.
That's cool. So, okay, so from now then, we'll come back to now and this year and sort of everything, but we want to go back as well to your first Grand Prix appearances. Very different. You're in Moto3, weren't you? And compared to where you are now, it was quite a difficult start you had to your Grand Prix career, I think it's fair to say. So how did it feel, though, the first time you came into the paddock, when it was quite a few years ago now? Like I said, Moto3, completely different situation.
Yeah, I made history, because everybody tells me about this. So it was very, very strange, a totally different situation. I think we were not ready to compete in the World Championship, because I didn't have enough experience on the Moto3, and also my team doesn't have enough experience. The bike was not at the level of the bike in the World Championship, so we struggled too much. It was a very difficult weekend. I don't remember sincerely the feelings, the emotions that I felt in that moment, but was very difficult. Then I used all this experience to improve, to grow a lot, and to also training harder, improving more, because I understood that I need to do something more for be a MotoGP rider in the future. So now I'm very happy to be here to achieve this very important goal for me, this dream.
Fran wrote a lot of the questions here. And actually, the next sort of question which I wrote down, which I think is perfectly timed, was that you learn a lot from success, but obviously the cliche is that you learn a lot more from your mistakes.
But it's true.
Yeah,
cliches
exactly.
Normally
yeah.
Exist
yeah.
For a reason, right?
Yeah.
You learn a lot from that experience. What you obviously say, you learn to train and to work harder. But what was, did anyone sit you down in that moment and go, right, okay, Luca, you weren't ready. That's okay. But here's what we're going to do.
Yeah.
What happened?
No, it's just more something inside, from my side, because I had many people around me that can give me some advices, some good advices, but my personal growth was much bigger. It's just something that I find from myself. I don't know how to explain, but when I grow up and I understand more everything, how this world is and how I have to compete, how I have to train, everything was a little bit easier. But it was a process inside that I made and tried to make also now to improve. Mm-hmm. Because, like you said before, I learned more from my mistakes than from the victories. And another example is last year, because I knew that I could win the championship, but at the end I finished second. But it was a very, very big, come si dice, spinta. A big push for improve more, for training harder this winter.
Nice.
And now I feel much more competitive and prepared for start this new season.
Can we ask about Le Mans then? I mean, that was, sorry to jump in, but there was a, we were going to ask about it later, because I feel like Le Mans, that crash there, which was honestly one of the scariest things I've ever seen.
Like replay king of the year.
Yeah,
I think we're allowed to say this now. Yeah. You're okay.
I won the crash of the year.
But
the crash of the decade, man. I mean, it's very easy to switch in mode commentating and not swearing or things like that. But that was very close to me saying something absolutely terrible.
Yeah.
But so I want to ask you about that, because I don't think I read in any English speaking media what the impact that crash had on the rest of your season. I don't know whether you explained it in the Italian media, but it's fair to say that after that, it took some races for your mojo, your confidence to really come back. Or was there another problem? Was it a physical problem? Tell us what we went through.
Well, for sure, that moment was the key moment of the season, because it is like this. You cannot explain in another different way that moment of the season. But the main problem was that after that crash, also I had an injury in the ankle, but also I make some damages on the bike that we didn't understand at the beginning. So I make Le Mans race and Aragon 1 race and Friday of Aragon 2 with the same bike in general. But then I was very slow. The feeling was not good every time. I had a lot of problems on the bike, more in the rear side of the bike, and we didn't understand why, because we changed a lot of stuff also, but the problem was every time the same. Then we changed the frame, and I came back to be a little bit more competitive in the Aragon 2, and also I start to take more points and to be on the championship fight for until the last race. Mm-hmm. So was a little bit these two things, because I did 1-0 in Le Mans and 1-0 in Aragon 1, and this makes the difference for the championship. And then also my ankle was not perfect, was not good for all the races till the end of the season, till now, sincerely, because it was a very long time to recovery. I'm not 100% yet, so it's not easy now. But I'm trying to do a lot of exercises for recover the mobility, especially. But now in the bike, I don't have problem to ride.
Well, so pretty much done now, that crash.
Yeah.
Not too many things to have to go back and revisit it.
Yeah.
Except when people ask you about it.
We'll only do it once, promise.
Yeah. But so what you said then about it is kind of your reputation is a rider who's like just calmly looks at all the things. It's like, okay, so I need to improve this, need to improve this, puts it all together. That seems to be like how you go racing, compared to some people maybe who get on the bike and just, oh, find out where the limit is within 5 minutes. You know what I mean? There's very different ways of approaching this. But I guess the people around you as well help you keep the way that you're working and keep putting those things together and the progress that you've made. And how is that with the academy? And you say it comes from you, but you have an amazing support system as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, the academy is working very well. They improved a lot from the beginning, from the start. So
you've got almost a lot of you in MotoGP now.
Yeah.
It's going to be there. In a few years. It's going to be like...
Yes. Yeah, we improve and we grow together. I think what makes the difference, especially, is the competition between us during all the training. Because if you train alone, when you find your limit, is okay. Then if you train with another rider, another MotoGP rider, so one of the best in the world, you try to push, and you try to push over your limit. So this, I think, was the key, the secret of the academy, because in every train, when we go running, when we train with the bikes, when we go in the karting at the ranch, in Misano with the stock bikes, you have to do your best performance. Yeah. So this, I think, is the key, is our secret. But it's not easy for the other riders maybe to try to do this. Yeah. But I know and I saw that so many riders now start training like this, yeah. Also in Spain. A lot of riders together. Also, Miller is riding. All the group in around Barcelona, Andorra, mm-hmm. they ride together, and they think this makes the difference.
I picture it like a random person like me at home wants to start running all the time or cycling and training and things like that. You're more likely to continue doing it and to get better if you have someone else with you, an accountability partner. To go out running or something like that with you. Yeah, I think exactly. It's the same thing.
Yeah, it's the same. It's the same because when I ride the bike, for example, in Misano, if I'm alone or I do a lap time and I'm happy to do that lap time because in my opinion is good, is enough. Yeah, yeah. But when there is, Franco or Pecco that give you 1/10 or 2/10, they are faster than you. You exit and you do another run. Mm-hmm. Pushing more and maybe you can be half a second faster than the run before. So this is very important for us because when you are here, FP1 is like this from the beginning. From
yeah,
the second lap, yeah, you have to push like hell. Like you said, I'm a very analytic person, but... when I'm on track,
you also need the
Every rider needed that.
Yeah, exactly. And then, so can we ask you about then also outside of just the academy guys, who is in your personal support system? Is there someone to encourage you if you're feeling sad on one day, or maybe after Le Mans you're feeling down, and they go, no, come on, you're good, come on, keep going, or someone who I don't know keeps you humble or things like that. Who is your personal circle that helps you stay on the right tracks?
About the other riders?
No. In people? You in your
anyone
life, the people.
In the normal side of life.
Family,
rather than the racing.
A friend outside of whatever.
Ah, okay.
Right.
Also outside of the academy.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, in who pushed me more for be a better rider and faster is my girlfriend.
Oh, yeah?
Really?
Yeah. She's never happy.
Really?
I love this because so many people have the girlfriend where it's like, no, you did really well. It's like, no, I didn't. But
yeah,
she's like, come on.
Like this.
Wow.
Too much. She destroyed me when I did fourth.
For anyone watching, she's just out of shot and she is listening to this as well. So I'm sure she's laughing, but that's really interesting. So yeah, tell us
and,
more about that.
About to be humble and with the foot on the ground, I think... our physical trainer.
All right.
He's very clear on this point, mm-hmm. also with the other guy. But in general, is something that you have inside. We have a very good ambient, a very good atmosphere when we train, when we travel, when also we are here in the paddock, because I like my crew also in the team when I was before. In the past years, there was a very good atmosphere, and also this helps you to stay in the correct direction.
I think I saw you guys last year maybe having a barbecue on one night, or at least some of the Sky guys, maybe Moto3, and I was so jealous. I was so jealous. I could just smell it on the way out the paddock.
Oh, yeah, a lot of times, for example, in Australia.
Australia is perfect barbecue as well, yeah, absolutely.
Brilliant. I was going to pass it on to you if you wanted to catch
Okay, well
out.
Then. So the girlfriend is really the...
a big part of the sport.
The brutal side of it. But that's quite interesting then as well. And obviously you have the academy guys. You said, like we say, you're an analytical rider. I want to ask as well about your route to here. Because you came Moto3 bike first appearance, didn't go very well. Then you did one season or a few races in CV Moto3.
Yeah.
And then you did CV Moto2.
Yes.
And I remember watching you back in, I think it was Navarra, and you were up there at the front, But some of the guys who were beating you that year are guys that now, 2-3 years later, you're 15 places ahead of in the World Championship. What's made that difference? Is it all these people and the academy and pushing yourself that much harder that's made that kind of switch?
Well, when you analyze the career of one rider, it's not easy to do a comparison, because the process, the travel of a rider, every rider has a different way, because when you start from with one bike, with Moto3, in the last year I was with Kalex, that for me was a disaster. I didn't have feeling. I'm sorry about for Kalex, because with the Moto2 bike was fantastic. But with the Moto3 was really, really difficult. I crashed a lot, and I lose a lot of feeling. So the next year I was in Moto2 with the team Pons, and was a really good team. I learned a lot from them, because there were a lot of people with a lot of experience in the World Championship, and then can teach me a lot of important things that I have already also now I use. And then was my first year in Moto2. So I did some podiums, I think. But the other riders were there from many years before. Like, for example, Edgar Pons, Vierge, other riders, Odendal, maybe.
Long time ago now.
Yeah, but they had more experience and they were a little bit more competitive than me. But then I go to the World Championship with Forward. I want to thank Kuzari, Giovanni Kuzari, because he believed in me from the beginning. And we start this adventure together. I make very good 2 years in Moto2, the first 2 years, because I did some good result and I learned a lot. Then I passed to Sky and I started to win races also, because all the everything was a little bit more better. Official team, you know, is the bike is a little bit better.
More staff.
More stuff, more spare parts. Everything was easier to do, and I started to win my first race, and was very happy, and it was very important. But you have to analyze, I think, and to do comparison between riders after they end their career. Now it's not easy. Maybe now Vierge in Moto2, but then you will come MotoGP rider, and you will see.
Interesting.
Yeah.
It's always interesting to see which rider really fits where sometimes. Sometimes you have an amazing year, and then something will just won't quite work again, and then it come back. And from the outside, not knowing, like, we know you work hard more than just on the bike. There's a lot of time in the garage talking to people, data, everything else. But not having lived through that experience, it can sometimes seem like a mystery. Mm-hmm. Like, how has this happened? But so many things from just a different tire pressure can send you know, a long distance behind, back or forward. It's
It's a lot of, you have to use your opportunities. Mm-hmm. When you have an opportunity, a very good opportunity, you have to do your best. You have to do, you have to win, to try to, I don't know, go in the next category, and try to build another opportunity. Mm-hmm. Now I am in a good team here in MotoGP. I think it is a good opportunity, but I want to be the best that I can for another better opportunity, maybe in the next years.
Yeah, I understand.
So it's also to try to use your opportunity, and when you have to be your best performance, you have to do your best performance.
Can I ask you on the subject of the hard work and everything like that? You're very fortunate. You've got a very good press officer. He's always very helpful for us when we have requests. Yeah. But whenever I need to do an interview with you after a day on the track in a test or free practice over the last few years, it's always been like, yeah, can you wait 1 hour, 1 hour 30? Because Luca's in the meeting with the mechanic and stuff like that, right? You spend so long in those meetings analyzing all the data lines, the track and everything. Does there ever come a time when you start looking at that and your eyes go fuzzy and you just go, oh, I can't anymore? That's it. Does it ever get to that point?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, a lot of times.
Yeah, okay,
a lot
good.
Of times.
Okay,
not,
cool.
Was a problem at one moment. Yeah,
okay.
Because too much data is not good for a rider.
Yeah, too much information.
Yeah, exactly.
Then you're like, but which part is the bit that you really focus on now?
Yeah.
Or, yeah.
In fact, from last year, I changed a little bit.
Oh, yeah?
This method. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, because too many hours behind the computer is not good for a rider. You have to focus on your things, and then the crew chief have to focus on.
Fair enough. You make it sound like you've done your day on track, and then you're like starting a day in the office.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, was not good. Now the problem is bigger because with the MotoGP you have so many
more things
more
to look
things,
at.
A lot, and then you can compare between five riders.
Right.
In Moto2 you are just two.
Yep.
But here with the Ducati, we are six in total.
Oh,
and
true,
then also
yeah,
Pirro, you can see.
Yeah, true.
So
good point.
If you start to check all the riders, it's a disaster.
Yeah.
Also by the crew chief, the guys that they work a lot. They spent a lot of time looking at the computer, so it's not easy also for them. Stay with me 2 or 3 hours because they have to do 8 hours of their job
and then
2 or 3 with me.
It's so nice that you're thinking of the other people in that aspect too, because I guess it can be quite difficult to understand, like, oh well, this is not just about me, you know, like, yeah, that really makes sense.
Also, yeah, exactly. They come here at 9 o'clock and then
we
watch the data.
What time did you arrive today?
Me at 12.
Yeah.
Then the last practice is at 9.
Yeah.
Then you start to look at the data.
Sometimes it breaks my heart when someone's had a big crash and you just see one pit box with the light on until like so late at night,
and they're just fixing the bike.
And then everyone else is like, bye.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, guys. But no, that's cool. So I think we should probably ready to trial our new quickfire format. But first, obviously, you are Valentino's brother. I'm sure you are bored of hearing that all the time because you're aware of it at home in your life. You've grown up with it. But there is one aspect of that we definitely want to ask you about, because it was a very cool moment in the test where we saw you guys do practice start, I think, together.
Yes.
And just sharing the track with him, how does that feel with also the guys from the academy? We've been racing each other, pushing each other in training, but like you said, maybe Franco's done a faster lap, and before, Franco is like the MotoGP rider, so you're trying to hit that. Now you're here with them. How does it feel to share the track with them, but then also with Valentino after kind of a few years to get here?
At home the feeling is different because now are them, so you have to beat them also in the training. When I saw them in the track, everybody was a little bit strange. It's different than to follow another rider, sincerely. Yeah. But I think that this is a thing that you have to be comfortable on this, make some experience, some kilometers on the bike, following also them, and then it will be as usual, the same to follow all the other riders. But it's better to share the track with them. I would like to be faster
and
as
beat them.
Obviously, you want them to be looking at you, but coming from behind rather than you looking up at them, right?
Yeah.
That's the main thing. I just want to ask on that bit. Is there a moment, because I guess some people at home might be wondering, if you're all on track together during the testing, people might think, testing's casual. Maybe they're lapping together and they're sort of looking at one another and sort of nodding and be like, whoa, let's go. Is there any time for that? Or is it like, no way, we have our stuff to do? Just focus on me or not?
Nah, it's difficult. Difficult to plan this. Maybe you can try to speak about the time when you start in the practice. so to be together. For example, we start at the green. So at the green, you said to the crew, okay, we go outside, and you can try to be in the same moment in the track. But in general, it's not so easy. You have to do your stuff, your plan, your laps, because maybe Frankie or Pec or Vale can do two laps, just this in a run. I have to do four for understand more the changes that we did on the bike or something like this, or the tires. I didn't have enough experience. But I try to follow them, especially Pecco, because we have the same bike. So also for the lines, I can understand and learn in an easier way, in a quicker way, following him.
Sweet.
That's cool.
Quick fire questions?
Well, yeah, let's try them out. As we said to you, we're intending to use these all year.
Yeah, same ones.
Depending if you hate them. Maybe we'll have to change them.
Yeah, let's see.
No spoilers.
Give you a bit of truth as well. Before we started this podcast, maybe 2 hours ago, we Googled quick fire questions.
Okay.
These are the best ones we could get.
Some of them were truly awful.
Yeah, some of them were really bad.
To a MotoGP rider.
Yeah. There's no Google page for that. But this is the best we could come up with. So I hope you and the listeners at home enjoy them. Do you want to start with the first one?
You start.
Okay, I'll
first.
Start. Where is your favorite place in the world? A individual place, a country, a city? Do you have one?
Country, Italy.
Obviously.
So patriotic.
I'm feeling great when I'm at home, but not my home. Home.
Yeah.
With my girlfriend, with my dogs, and with my family close, in the close town.
Very wholesome.
Yeah.
Best place in the world is home. Lovely.
Yeah.
Nice.
What about your first celebrity crush?
So.
And I've learnt the Italian word cotta in case crush we needed to explain.
What is this?
Cotta? No?
Cotta.
Avere una cotta, no?
Ah, okay.
Yeah, like that's what I was like. I'm gonna Google this because crush is like a hard word.
Oh yeah. I got that.
First celebrity crush.
Celebrity.
Yeah. We thought we might get some funny answers to this, but if you can't even remember.
I am very particular on this side.
Yeah. Okay.
I pretend a lot.
Right.
I find so many details.
Really?
In all the women in general.
No celebrity pleased you.
when I was younger, for sure, Megan Fox in the film Transformer.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah.
That's a very generational thing.
We can all agree on that. Yeah.
If I have to choose not celebrity, the first one is my girlfriend.
Of course.
Oh,
trying to repair some of the damage done.
We know when we were a child at the school.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. That's so lovely.
Yeah.
I love that the look she just gave him was, too right, mate. Absolutely. Okay. Next one then. What is your favorite dessert?
A difficult choice. Or crepe with Nutella or tiramisu.
Tiramisu is a good choice.
Very good choices.
Nice. Crepe with Nutella is easier to do. Also, I can do it at home.
Yeah. This is true. Everyone. Tiramisu,
tiramisu,
quite a project.
Yeah, for me is too much. But when I'm a restaurant, tiramisu.
What about, do you have any phobias or strange fears or superstitions?
For now, no.
Not cool. Spiders or snakes or anything?
No.
Nothing.
Wow. Mr. Cool over here, no problem. Okay, last
one. Yeah, but I didn't face with a shark now, so maybe...
It's not nothing in the world scares him.
Yeah.
It's that he has no irrational fear.
That's the one.
One time I was in the shark pool.
Oh, yeah?
In the...
What country?
In Cattolica. We have...
There's a shark pool in Cattolica?
Le Navi is an aquatic park.
Ah, and they
go down with the bubble, with all the protection.
How funny.
My ultimate fear is sharks.
Yes.
Like really? When I was little, I couldn't even put my head under the water in the bath because I thought that sharks would come. Like that's how bad it was.
That's very
now
rough.
I'm okay and I could just stay calm.
Okay.
As long as there are people further in the sea than me and then I can see them get pulled under and killed by the shark and run away, then I'm fine.
Okay. So spiders are mine, always have been, always.
Yeah, spiders. No. Also
in my house, I have a lot of spiders.
That your friend. Well, the dogs can eat those. I mean, yeah. They're so small, right?
They can eat mosquitoes.
So that's why I started to like them. Yeah.
In Italy, he said that they bring you money.
Well, we have the small spiders in the UK are called money spiders.
Yeah,
the baby ones.
I guess the same thing, right? Last one. Okay, you can have dinner with three people, dead or alive. Who are they? Anyone in the world. That's ever been.
Nah, too difficult this question. It's not a fire question.
No, it's true.
It's an essay question.
As analytical about this as he is in the data in the Moto2 bike.
I don't know. For sure, one dead important man to try to make some question. I would like to know it. I don't know.
We have some advice.
No?
Not sure.
I'm like, come
you?
On.
You?
For me, I'd like... Jimi Hendrix has always been one of mine.
Yeah?
Yeah. I don't quite know why. And also my childhood motorcycle racing hero, Steve Hislop. I don't know whether you've ever heard that name.
No.
So he was, for the listeners at home might be going, oh yeah! But Steve Hislop was a Scottish, British superbikes and Isle of Man TT rider. He was my hero growing up, but he died in a helicopter crash in like 15 years ago now.
Okay.
But he was really good. I would like to have had dinner with him.
Mine are not TT. Mine are Ayrton Senna, David Bowie, and then like a fight between Freddie Mercury and John Lennon for the final seat.
Zarko said Paul McCartney last year.
Yeah?
Yeah.
He deleted Valentino from his original choices to add Paul McCartney.
Okay. No, I didn't go to music. I would like to be in another world, more scientific, less artistic.
Okay. So like, literally just people where you can ask them stuff you want to
know.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's cool.
About the universe, like, I don't know, Stephen Hawking.
I think
that's cool.
I think
but in a better situation, Stephen Hawking, that can...
Before his illness,
feed himself,
really, he can
using
have
his hand.
The dinner with you.
Yeah, or... some people that have a very good knowledge about everything.
Uh-huh.
Trying to make him some question to understand how all the words.
I really like that. Even if you've not named anybody,
find someone on Google.
And people and with knowledge. Yeah. Einstein?
Look at it.
Too much. Too much.
Someone less obvious.
Less obvious, less math, and more.
More like,
like
Steve
the
Jobs.
World in general.
Steve Jobs, we just bad, yeah.
Steve.
Well, it depends on your perspective on that one, doesn't it? But yeah. I tell you what, we'll leave that there. But I think that's a good answer anyways. We might have to keep that one, but we'll probably say it as the first question in future, shall we?
Yeah, maybe.
And give them time to think. You know? So that'd be brilliant. Luca, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it, because this is a huge weekend for you. So thanks so much.
Yes, thank you so much.
And yeah, good luck.
Yeah, best of luck.
Much.
Enjoy it.
Yeah,
and it's great as well. We'd like to celebrate the fact that we still have the beautiful Sky VR46 colours in MotoGP now, because it is probably the nicest livery in the paddock.
Yeah, it's
We're
nice,
not
it's
supposed
nice.
To have favourites.
Yeah, also under the lights.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't have to change uniform.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah,
I
have a great weekend.
I try to put this livery forward
exactly,
in the
that's
grid.
Your challenge. Come on. Do it for the colour scheme.
Okay.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
So that was the Luca Marini first interview of the season done. We're maybe a little bit rusty. We're trying to get back in gear.
I
hope you enjoyed it anyway. I think we
the
did
chat
right
was good.
The first one.
I think,
chat
I
was
think
good.
The main rustiness is the intros and outros,
yeah,
to be
I
honest.
Think so.
But,
and
yeah.
I think it always helps as well when you have a guest who is, easy to talk to, always
very much.
Polite, smile. Yeah.
And has been working on his English over the winter, he tells us, as well, in preparation for his first MotoGP season. You'll be listening to this after the Qatar GP is done and dusted, so because we're recording this on the Thursday. So we hope you enjoyed that. There is, of course, a GP next weekend, and we'll be recording another podcast. So this is released on the Wednesday. We're actually recording another podcast tomorrow, if you're listening to this on the day of publication. So wait to find out
time
who that's
travel.
With.
I panicked then. I was like, I don't have time to do another one tomorrow. But you mean if you're listening.
Yes.
Okay. So thanks very much for joining us. Like we said before, review, hashtag, get in touch, all the usual stuff. And hopefully listen to us and see you again soon.
Bye for now.